Good afternoon. Welcome to Grand Rounds today. As I always do, I will remind you to fill out the attendance record at the back of the auditorium and also to fill out the program evaluations and turn those in. If you could give us any ideas in regards to future topics or future speakers, we would be appreciative. Today, I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Judy Streit. Dr. Streit attended to her undergraduate education here at Iowa State. She then went to the University of Iowa, where she attended medical school, did her internal medicine residency, her infectious disease fellowship, and is now associate professor of medicine, and she's also the director of the fellowship program in infectious disease there. She was kind enough to accept our invitation today to update us on tick-borne diseases, and please join me in welcoming Dr. Streit.
All right, so am I, can you hear me well? All right, so it's good to be here. I appreciate the invitation, and I'm thankful on a couple things. One is it's always good to come back to Ames, and secondly, the roads were okay today. So I hope today that the topic will be pertinent for those of you who are doing primary care or doing specialty care, and it's a topic that is evolving with some momentum, and we'll talk about some of the newer things that are occurring as well in the arena of tick-borne diseases. But hopefully we'll be covering good solid ground regarding Lyme disease, which is the most common tick-borne illness that we see. So the objectives today are to be familiar with Lyme disease in the U.S., and I make that comment about the U.S. because there are some variations in European Lyme disease, and that probably has to do mostly with the different species that occur there. But when I say that, be familiar, it refers particularly to the epidemiology, the chronology of clinical manifestations, diagnostic pitfalls, and treatment, and be familiar as well with less common tick-borne infections such as ehrlichiosis and anaplasmosis, Rocky Mountain spotted fever, Babesia infection, and some emerging diseases. So you can't have a tick talk without having tick pictures. So shown here are examples of the most common ticks. So A through C that you see here are all, we'll see here, are all examples of the Ixodes tick. And Ixodes is sort of infamous for the multiple organisms that it can transmit. So it can be a vector with a lot of manifold diseases that it brings with it. So Borrelia burgdorferi, or the agent of Lyme disease. More recently, there are some other Borrelia species that are in the literature. Miyamotoi, we'll talk a little bit about that, Mayonii from the Mayo Clinic, and then as well Babesia organisms, anaplasma organisms, and then more recently an encephalitis virus of Powassan. D shows the amblyomma tick, which carries Ehrlichia infections. E is Dermacentor, is the vector of Rocky Mountain spotted fever. And then this little soft shell tick down there is, I don't know how to pronounce this necessarily, I'm going to say Ornithoderus. And if there are people in the audience who know better, you're going to correct me in a nice fashion. But this is the vector for some of the relapsing fever organisms. So I showed this next picture to demonstrate that if you have a larval form of a tick, these are going to be remarkably small. So you can see these could readily be missed by someone who's doing a tick check after a camping trip or time in the woods, et cetera. And after 96 hours of engorgement of a blood meal, yes, it does significantly grow in size, but just recognize how tiny these little creatures can be. With the more mature tick, there is before engorgement and then 96 hours after blood engorgement. So just recognize that, in part I show this to say if patients aren't aware of a tick bite, it doesn't mean that they haven't had a tick bite because they may not have recognized the very tiny ticks that are can occur, especially more in the spring and early summer season. So this map is from the CDC, and it shows reported cases of Lyme disease in 2015. So the blue dots recognize cases of Lyme disease, and this is where the person with the diagnosis lives, not necessarily where they may have acquired their infection. But you can see, and I think most of you are familiar with the hot spots for Lyme disease, so up in the northeast, and then you are on the edge of another hot spot in the upper Midwest, and then there are a few other spots in the Pacific Northwest and along the West Coast. But obviously, the ones that are most pertinent to us are going to be patients who spend time or people who spend time in this area. All right. And then from the ISU Department of Entomology, looking at tick populations, this was a surveillance that was reported in 2009. And you can see here the size of the circle shows the number of ticks that were evaluated. And then the pie chart shows the type of ticks that were found. So here in Story County, you have Ixodes made up around, 20%, something like that. The Dermacentaur made up the largest percentage, and then a small number of the Amblyomma americanum. And then over here in my territory, you can see that the Ixodes tick makes up the majority of ticks that were tested or found and evaluated. Some additional ISU data on Lyme cases between the years 2006 and 2015, and I believe this is Story County, right? So down in Polk County, number were 85 cases, 15 in Story County. And then again, territory where I'm coming from, you can see the numbers are significantly higher. All right, so during this talk, I'm going to present some cases. So this is the part where I say, this is going to be interactive, and please raise your hands or speak up and feel free. And as we say at the school, there are no wrong answers. So case one, this is a 22-year-old farmer from Dubuque who presents in July with 4 days of fever, myalgias, and headache. On exam, his temperature was 37.5, vital signs were stable, he was not acutely ill, and this is the rash that was noted. All right. So what is the next best step? And I realize I should have one of the foils be here of, cephalexin and doxycycline or something, but I didn't because one doesn't know necessarily that that may be a tick-borne illness. But of the foils that are shown here, what is the next best step? One, you want to make a diagnosis, and so you're going to set up for skin biopsy or an aspirate of that skin for Borrelia PCR. So you're going to be in communication with your lab saying, where can I send a PCR? Second option is do a Lyme IgM Western blot, and your treatment then would depend on the results of that. The third option is to do a Lyme screening antibody. Next is to give cefuroxime, 500 milligrams BID for 28 days, or lastly, doxycycline, 100 milligram BID for 14 days. All right. Anyone want to choose number one? You want to make a diagnosis. Number two, to do Western blot. Again, try to make a diagnosis. And anyone want to do the screening antibody test? Cefuroxime for 28 days? All right, and lastly, anyone want to do doxycycline? All right, so the majority of people are choosing doxycycline, and that's the correct answer. So I bring this case, which is a little basic, to bring up a couple points regarding early Lyme disease. So it is usually a clinical diagnosis. The early localized infection is referred to as stage one, and localized erythema migrans rash is the typical manifestation of that. I should point out that only half of the rashes are target lesions, and so you probably recognize the one that I showed you was more a confluent erythema and didn't have the classic target aspects to it. The erythema migrans occurs in 60 to 80% of patients who acquire Lyme disease. The incubation is anywhere from half a week up to 4 weeks, so quite a wide variation in how many days before the rash is manifest. Duration of the rash is typically days to weeks, and that in part depends on whether or not there's treatment. A flu-like illness may or may not be present, so you may have someone who is otherwise asymptomatic who shows up with a rash, or you may have patients with fevers and chills showing up with the rash. You may also have regional lymphadenopathy, and serology is unreliable. So I think none of you were inclined to rely on serology to make a clinical diagnosis or to proceed with treatment. All right, so this is an article from Alan Steer in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2001 showing some other rashes of Lyme disease. So you can see in the popliteal area just sort of confluent erythema. And I think if someone were presenting to us with that rash, I would have a hard time saying I think that's Lyme disease, but just keep an open mind of the different manifestations of Lyme disease, primary disease. Here's a more typical target lesion. And then you can have some lesions as well that may have a vesicular component to that or look like sort of a contact dermatitis again. So I show these to have you be aware of the diversity of manifestations. So now we have case number two. This is a 50-year-old landscaper from Iowa City who presented in July with 8 days of fever and malaise. The exam showed multiple oval erythematous patches scattered over the thorax and extremities, sparing palms and soles. Okay. So what is the most likely cause of his rash? One, there are multiple sites of inoculation of Borrelia burgdorferi due to the multiple tick bites. He has anaplasmosis, so a different tick-borne illness. He has early disseminated Lyme disease, or he has tularemia, which is due to a Francisella infection. All right, and I'm afraid my slide may have just gone ahead, but if it didn't, I will ask you, so who thinks that the multiple lesions are due to multiple tick bites? Anyone here would be most concerned about that? Secondly, do you think it's a different disease altogether, such as anaplasmosis or tularemia? And then who thinks that it is a manifestation of early dissemination of Borrelia burgdorferi? All right, so that slide doesn't want to stay up. So those of you who said that, yes, that this is early disseminated Lyme disease. So now I'm going to talk about what are some of the other manifestations of early disseminated Lyme disease. We've talked about the skin, or shown an example of the skin with the secondary erythema migrans lesions. The onset of those lesions can be days to weeks after the infection occurs, and about 50% of people who would be untreated can develop manifestations like that, and systemic symptoms are generally present when you see multiple lesions like that because you now have disseminated disease. Another organ that is often involved in early disseminated Lyme disease is the neurologic, CNS disease or other nerves involved. So the classic manifestations are lymphocytic meningitis. You can also have cranial neuritis manifest as a bad headache, and these can be sort of mysterious that they may be very strong for periods of time and then let up for a time and come back. You can also have radiculoneuritis or myelitis. The onset can be days to months after infection. The percent of patients involved, if they are not treated, and you can imagine these are from the very early days when before Lyme disease was fully understood, that's how you acquired your understanding of what percentage of untreated patients go on to develop these complications, but about 15 to 20% of patients would develop neurologic complications. Systemic symptoms, yes, are usually present, but not always. Another manifestation is cardiac disease. So patients can have carditis. This can manifest at AV nodal block or myopericarditis. Again, the onset is days to months after acquisition of infection. A lesser percentage of people have this complication without treatment, and that's about 5 to 10%, and you may or may not have systemic symptoms present. Musculoskeletal manifestations are present, including or classically as migratory pain and inflammation affecting joints, days or months in onset, and you may or may not have systemic symptoms. And lastly, I'll include the eye, and patients may have conjunctivitis or other eye disease. So I'll just present a couple other patients who had manifestations of early disseminated Lyme disease. So this was a 70-year-old male who had 3 days of weakness, pain in his right lower extremity, right upper extremity. He had had severe midline back pain for about a week. He had an elevated post-void residual. So in talking with him more, he reported that about a month prior, he had a flu-like illness, which resolved on its own. And at the time when he came into the hospital, his spine MRI showed some pretty diffuse leptomeningeal enhancement around the cord. His CSF showed 600 white cells, 70% of those were lymphocytes. And his limb weakness was pretty impressive. And I think there was a lot of relief when it was recognized that this was something that hopefully was going to be readily treatable. This is another patient that I'll show her EKG. So this is a 40-year-old female who presented in August with 3 days of palpitations and lightheadedness. And she reported that about 2 months before, she had found an unattached tick. And when we hear a history like that of an unattached tick, to me, that's mostly an indicator that this person had a story that tells us that there was tick exposure and that the unattached tick was probably not the one that transmitted Lyme disease to her, but it tells us that circumstances were correct for, were possible for her to have a tick-borne illness. And so this is her EKG. So the cardiologists were concerned about heart block. And then her serology was positive, as well as the IgG Western blot. And so her diagnosis was secondary Lyme disease, and she responded well to treatment. So now we're going into topics about late Lyme disease, and the classic sites of involvement are the joints, neurologic manifestations, and the skin. The skin typically is a European phenomenon and not found here in the U.S. First, let's talk about joint disease. So the onset is typically months to years after acquisition of infection. Typical manifestation is either a arthritis involving one joint or several joints, and classically the knee or knees are involved. The percent of patients who have this manifestation, if they're not treated, is close to or over 50%, and typically you do not have, or patients don't have, systemic signs or symptoms. Neurologic disease can occur, and this, again, onset is typically months to years after infection, typically manifests as peripheral neuropathy or neuritis, so this can manifest either as a sensory impairment, or patients may have severe radicular pain. Usually systemic signs and symptoms are not present. And then I'll show you a picture in a little bit about the acrodermatitis chronica atrophica, which is a manifestation that's found in the European forms of Lyme. All right, so a picture of Lyme arthritis. So you can see the patient's right knee here is swollen. A few more details about Lyme arthritis. It's typically recurrent. It's posiarticular. Usually large joints are involved. Cool effusions are present. Baker cyst may be one of the manifestations. And then in the minority of patients, they can have persistent synovitis that persists for months or years, so it doesn't nearly wax or it doesn't wax and wane, it just stays present. And this persists despite treatment. I will talk a little bit more about this manifestation in a bit, but what I will say at this point in time is that the evidence does not support that this is due to chronic infection. Okay, so we'll talk a little bit more about why people may have such persistent signs and symptoms despite treatment. Enthesopathy can also be present in terms of inflammation of the tendons. There is a genetic risk, so there's patients who have certain HLA factors genetically are at increased risk for this manifestation, and there are rare reports of autoimmune disease that can occur months after the diagnosis. So the question is the Borrelia able to trigger an autoimmune phenomenon after infection? Okay, and then the late neurologic manifestations are rare. I mentioned already a chronic axonal polyneuropathy can be present, manifest in distal paresthesias. Diffuse axonal change can be found on EMG and NCV. Patients can have chronic local peripheral neuritis. I mentioned the radicular pain. And the encephalopathy is a bit unclear, in part because it is often difficult to demonstrate objectively that patients have cognitive impairment. I would say there are many experts who believe that the reported fogginess of thinking, et cetera, may be more related to an underlying systemic illness, and so they don't equate the encephalopathy with chronic active neurologic infection, strictly speaking. And then this is a picture of the acrodermatitis chronica atrophica. And you can see here, you have the sense that there is atrophy of the skin. There's often this sort of violaceous or deep red kind of burnished color to the skin. And that can be present, as you can imagine, in multiple different parts of the body. So this little diamond shape here is to make the point that either in early infection or in late disseminated infection, you have limited organ involvement, and it's in the early disseminated disease that you can have more broad organ involvement. So the diagnosis of Lyme disease, the important things to arrive at a working diagnosis are to first assess the signs and symptoms. Are those signs and symptoms that the patient's presenting with, are they consistent with Lyme disease? Is there a history of possible exposure to Ixodes ticks? Laboratory tests are not recommended in the absence of typical signs or symptoms, and laboratory tests can be helpful if they're used correctly and performed with validated methods. Touchy. Okay, so typically for serologic diagnosis, what's recommended by the CDC is to use two-tier serology for second and third third stage Lyme disease. So first of all, there's an ELISA test or an EIA screening antibody, and this is typically done with a whole cell sonicate of the Borrelia organisms. And if that test is negative, then it's recommended that you stop testing. If it's positive, then that's followed by Western blot testing, and which Western blot you primarily pay attention to depends on how far into the illness that patient is. So if the patient is early in the illness, so for example within the first month, then it would be the IgM Western blot that may be your best indicator of true Lyme infection, and if they're later in their disease, so more than 4 weeks, then IgG is typically the preferred Western blot. So to make that point again, IgM Western blot, the criteria for positivity are greater than or equal to 2 of the 3 bands. You can see false positives here, and so one always has to be taking into account where you are in the time frame of that illness in terms of how you interpret it, and to consider getting a follow-up IgG Western blot several weeks down the road for confirmation. to have a positive IgG Western blot, the criteria is to have, or the criterion is to have more than or equal 5 of the 10 bands that are positive, and that you should be more than 4 weeks into the illness. For patients who are 3 to 4 weeks into the illness, there's a sensitivity of the IgG Western blot of 65% to 75%. If you are beyond 4 and close to 8 weeks, the sensitivity is significantly higher. So some caveats regarding serologic testing is that 40% of healthy people have a 41 kilodalton band positive. And so if you have reports showing that band as being one of the only bands, that in and of itself should not raise concern that, oh my gosh, this is early Lyme disease, et cetera. And also recognize that the antibodies may persist for years. So if you have someone who 2 years ago had a diagnosis of Lyme disease, you would anticipate that they could well still have positive serology. And so positive serology at testing now wouldn't be able to tell you, unless there were other circumstances to point to new infection, that this person had a new infection. So some other comments about how often you should expect to see positive serology at different with different manifestations of Lyme disease. Erythema migrans, some of the quotes are 29% of those patients have positive serology. With early disseminated disease, many authors are comfortable saying that virtually all patients have positive serology, and with late Lyme disease, similar phenomenon, many experts would say virtually all of those patients, if they've not been treated, have positive serology. Some serology missteps are to use serology at the time of erythema migrans lesion, and by that I mean if you're going to trust that that serologic test is going to give you true information, then you may not treat patients who warrant treatment with primary lesion of erythema migrans. If you perform an ELISA or another enzyme test without a Western blot, that could be another misstep in terms of making a diagnosis of Lyme disease when the full serologic panel wouldn't support that. Another issue that can occur is to perform the Western blot without the screening ELISA, and that can also lead to overdiagnosis. Treating based on a positive chronic antibody is another possible misstep for reasons I've already mentioned. And if you use the IgM Western blot alone for a patient who's had their illness for more than 4 weeks because of the false positives that can occur, that would be another way that an overdiagnosis of Lyme disease could be made. Some other tests for Lyme disease that are employed in certain laboratories is what is referred to as a second-generation antibody assay, and that uses a particular peptide of the Borrelia organism known as a C6 peptide, and that is used for an enzyme test. And that can take the place in certain labs for the Western blot, and I'll explain a little bit more about that. Some of the benefits of using the C6 peptide in the ELISA is that you may have an earlier IgG positivity, and you may be able to forego then the IgM testing, or you may better detect false positives. And in some labs, it is now part of two-tier testing. Okay, so if you see that on the report, just recognize that in some labs that is now considered a valid component or an alternate component in the two-tier testing. Microbiology laboratory testing, and by that I mean doing culture or PCR, has limited utility. Culture requires special media. There are some, I would say this is more in research in this day and age, that people would be culturing erythema migrans lesions. PCR, where that is most typically used, is synovial fluid, and in that manifestation, it's superior to culture. In terms of being able to find positive tests. When people perform CSF, or when people look for antibodies in the CSF, recognize that in acute meningitis, they're often positive, but in other manifestations of CNS disease, it's not reliable. All right, so pretest probability of Lyme disease. This is a chart that was derived from a 2005 article in the Family Practice Journal, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time here, but just recognize that it's always important to think about pretest probability before doing Lyme disease testing. So if you have someone who has not been in an area where there are Ixodes ticks, then one would have to think carefully about how you're going to use that information, recognizing that with false positives, you would be setting a situation up that you may be making creating a diagnosis where there isn't a diagnosis. But some general guidelines, if the person has been in an area that either is has low probability of Ixodes ticks or absent, if they have signs or symptoms suggestive of Lyme disease, pretest probability is moderate to low. Should you do testing? If you're compelled by the signs and symptoms, yes, you can do testing. And then if you have someone who, again, has been in an area of low endemicity or absent, if they have nonspecific symptoms that are not very compelling as being manifestations of Lyme disease, the pretest probability is low, and you would need to consider carefully whether or not it's warranted to do Lyme disease. And the other forms where the endemicity is moderate or high, then you can see that you either do testing, yes, and if the everything is pointing to this is Lyme disease, then you don't necessarily need to do testing. And I would say that's especially true in erythema migrans, as I've mentioned. Okay, so is it warranted to give prophylaxis after a tick bite, Lyme prophylaxis? So an article published in 2001 in the New England Journal of Medicine showed that there was an 87% decrease in erythema migrans occurring after doxycycline for one dose was given. So if your target is to reduce Lyme disease after a tick bite where you're concerned about Ixodes tick, then yes, that is a recommendation. The dose is 200 milligrams times one, and if these criteria are met, then it would be prudent to do that. So that some of those criteria are an Ixodes tick has been attached for more than or equal to 36 hours, it's been less than 72 hours from the tick removal, that the local rate of tick infection by Borrelia burgdorferi is greater than 20%, and that there's no contraindication to doxycycline. Okay, some recommended Lyme antibody regimens, Lyme antibiotic regimens are shown here. So the preferred oral regimens are doxycycline, amoxicillin, or cefuroxime. There are some alternate oral agents for people who have serious allergies, et cetera, and some of these are some of the macrolide agents. The preferred parenteral regimen is ceftriaxone. All right, so what's shown here is a chart of what are your recommended routes of treatment and duration. I'm not going to go into all of these, but I think the ones I'll draw your attention to is that for patients who have meningitis or radiculitis, then generally parenteral therapy is still in the IDSA guidelines. Some things I will say is that those guidelines are now fairly old. I think they're about 10 or 11 years old. And many people would argue that the European literature would support that oral doxycycline likely has similar activity as does the ceftriaxone. Some people though would have some word of caution because they would say, well, we don't have the literature supporting that in the U.S. and because the species that cause Lyme disease are somewhat different. I think many people here in the U.S., if you had someone who had meningitis, would consider more strongly still using ceftriaxone, but just recognize that there is literature in the European community that doxycycline works well also. For cardiac disease, typically if the heart block or the manifestation of cardiac disease is quite serious, we'll often start out with parenteral therapy and then transition over to oral as you see improvement in the EKG. And then arthritis, typically oral is recommended for 28 days. Okay, so this is an article that was published fairly recently talking about those patients who have persistent manifestations of inflammatory arthritis despite proper treatment. And I will, hone down on a couple things. So we're going to say, yes, the person meets appropriate criteria for diagnosis of Lyme disease. And the initial treatment was given per the IDSA guidelines, so they received, let's say, oral doxycycline. But let's say now you have a patient who has mild persistent arthritis despite following the recommended treatment. So this article would recommend treating with an additional 30 days of doxycycline. And now instead we have a patient who has moderate to severe persistent arthritis, and they would favor giving that patient ceftriaxone for 30 days as per the IDSA guidelines. And then after that, if you're having a patient who continues to have persistent arthritis after antibiotics, then you would approach this as a rheumatologist would approach a patient who has inflammatory arthritis. So if arthritis is mild, then they would treat with NSAID or hydroxychloroquine. If it's moderate to severe, methotrexate. And if you're having arthritis persisting for 3 to 6 months despite your prior medications, including other disease-modifying medications, consider synovectomy. All right. So the next topic is about post-Lyme disease symptoms. I would say over the last several years, some of the people who have dedicated most of their professional life to thinking about Lyme disease are using terminology about in two different ways. So there are some patients who present with pain, which may be headache or arthralgia, or fatigue for weeks to months after standard antibiotics that then go on to resolve. They would classify them as post-Lyme disease symptoms, and they estimate that about 10% of patients fall into this category. So these are patients who were appropriately treated, but they still have persistent symptoms for weeks to months. Another category of people are those who seem to have the onset of a variety of manifestations, such as diffuse joint or muscle pain, fatigue, neurocognitive problems, anxiety, depression, that begin months after treatment and last for years or indefinitely. The current theory among these experts is that there may be some central sensitization syndrome that has occurred in those patients, where how the synapses are being affected by that prior infection has now changed the neurologic function of those people and make them more acutely aware of pain. Prolonged antibiotic treatment has not been shown to provide sustained benefit, or that the risk to benefit ratio has been shown to be favorable toward prolonged treatment. And some of the articles that have dealt with providing data on some of those studies are shown there. What they've also found more recently is that the antibody profile differs for those patients who have post-Lyme disease symptoms. And I should say another thing, when you have the persistence of these symptoms for 6 months or more, then people are, some of the writers, authors in this area are now using the term post-Lyme disease syndrome. Okay. So I think there has been some increasing understanding based on the immune system of these patients has been triggered. There are detectable abnormalities in these patients, and that there may be, we may be moving toward a better understanding about what is it about that infection that has then changed some aspects of the neurologic function of these patients. I'm going to mention briefly an entity called STARI, and this is Southern Tick-Associated Rash Illness, and this is an erythema migrans mimic. Recently, the organism has been given a name, detected and given a name, a Borrelia lone starii. The vector is different. It's not the Ixodes tick, but it's an amblyomma tick. It's in the southeast U.S. Patients with this illness can have an erythema migrans rash, which is virtually identical to Lyme disease, but often they're less systemically ill than patients who have Lyme disease. Chronic complications are not known for this infection. There are not serologic tests yet, and the treatment is doxycycline or amoxicillin. So just recognize if you're seeing someone who has been coming from Missouri or southern Iowa and they have, what for all the world, what looks like a Lyme erythema migrans rash, but they have, I guess you wouldn't be doing serology anyway, if for some reason the serology was done in the future and it didn't support Lyme, that could be one reason. All right, so the next case we're going to talk about is a 40-year-old Amish farmer from Fort Madison, so far southern Iowa, and he comes with 1 week of fevers, chills, headache, malaise, myalgias, anorexia, and then for 2 days he's had abdominal pain and shortness of breath. On physical exam, he's febrile. There's increased work of breathing. He has conjunctivitis. There's a fine, blanching, macular, papular rash on the thorax, but no presence of an eschar. On labs, he has a normal white cell count, actually kind of low, but his band count is significantly high, so he has a significant left shift. Platelet count is low at 44,000, and AST and ALT are 355 and 389. So what's the most likely diagnosis here? One, ehrlichiosis. Two, Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Three, Lyme disease. Or four, tularemia, so Francisella infection. So those of you who think this may be ehrlichiosis, anyone want to raise a hand? All right, two, Rocky Mountain spotted fever. So a few people concerned for that. Lyme disease. This is a Lyme talk, right? Okay, and then tularemia, Francisella infection. And some people don't have an opinion, and that's all right. So I'm going to ask one other question. So now the heme lab calls you and says, you know, there are these funny things we're seeing in the monocytes. And you can see the arrow there points to these purple bodies in the cytoplasm. All right. So that might shift some of your thinking, or might move some of you toward making a diagnosis. So this is a case of ehrlichiosis, and the picture that we looked at here, these are known as morulae that are, with ehrlichiosis, they're present in the monocyte. We'll talk about the derivation of the ehrlichiosis name or the HME name. And so these are developing bacteria in the cytoplasm of the monocytes. So these organisms have a tropism for the monocytes. But you don't always see that, so you can't rely on the heme lab to help you make the diagnosis. So some rickettsial diseases of the central U.S. are shown here. So ehrlichiosis has been referred to fairly recently as human monocytic ehrlichiosis when we were using the ehrlichiosis term or ehrlichia term for anaplasma as well. So now we just basically refer to it as ehrlichia infection. Infects monocytes, and the vector here is the amblyomma americanum tick. Another rickettsial disease in the U.S., which used to be called human granulocytic ehrlichiosis, is now been renamed as anaplasma, as its genus name. It infects neutrophils, and so if you were to see morulae with this organism, they would now be present in neutrophils. And just be aware, because your vector is the same as Lyme, and Babesia, that you may have co-infections in particularly unfortunate people. There are tri-infections that have been described as well. But it's something to think about when you have a person who have any of these Ixodes tick-borne illnesses. Rocky Mountain spotted fever, yes, can occur quite uncommonly in the central U.S. This infects the endothelium, can cause a small vessel vasculitis and multi-organ system failure. All right, so clinical features of rickettsial disease. I think we're all familiar with the fever, headache, myalgia, malaise, so you can think of this as sort of the summertime influenza-type illness without the respiratory symptoms. Rash can be present, but not always in these infections. So with Rocky Mountain spotted fever, eventually 90% of children develop the rash, but it is not uncommon for this rash to occur after the first medical appointment, and so it can be more than 2 to 3 to 4 days into the illness. And so it's important to have this on your differential diagnosis for someone who's coming to you, even if you don't see the typical rash on the limbs. With the ehrlichiosis, rash can occur occasionally. Rash is rare in human granulocytic ehrlichiosis, or I should probably refer to that as anaplasma. Infrequently with these illnesses, there can be abdominal pain, so people may be focusing, or people trying to make diagnosis may be focusing on the abdomen as opposed to thinking more about a systemic illness, or there can be meningoencephalitis. The lab manifestations, you may often see decreased white blood cell, or you might see a low normal white cell but with a left shift, and often platelets are low. Often AST and ALT are elevated, okay? And what I mentioned just now about the left shift is especially true for Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Shown here are some of the pictures of Rocky Mountain spotted fever rash. So you're probably familiar with the limbs, especially showing first up around the ankles, for example, macular papular rash. Here it's more severe. And then this shows some of the gangrenous change that can occur, which is in part related to the vasculitis that occurs with this infection. So other illnesses that should be on the differential diagnosis if you're considering tick-borne rickettsial disease, those would include disseminated Neisseria infection, enteroviral infection, secondary syphilis, parvovirus, leptospirosis, EBV, TTP, a drug reaction, and rheumatologic disease. All right, so the distribution of vectors that can transmit ehrlichiosis and anaplasmosis are shown here. So we have alluded to the Ixodes vector, which transmits anaplasma in the upper Midwest and up here in the Northeast. And then I show this map mostly to show where the typical vector of ehrlichiosis is. And that is more here in the South and Southeast U.S., but recognize that we're certainly seeing in Southern Iowa, we're seeing ehrlichiosis present there. All right, and then Rocky Mountain spotted fever incidence by state. You can see Iowa is very low, so 0.1 to 1 per 1 million persons. So it can occur, but it's rare. Clues to rickettsial disease, think about recreational or occupational exposure. Have people traveled to endemic areas the Southeast and Northeast? Is there illness in family members, coworkers, pets? And as I mentioned earlier, the absence of a tick bite history does not exclude the diagnosis. So the management and treatment of tick-borne rickettsial disease, use the history, the symptoms, the exam and labs. If there are no strong clues, you may want to watch and wait for 24 to 48 hours, but I think it's very important to have a plan that you're going to follow up with that patient in a fairly short order. If there are enough clues to say that you're going to treat empirically, Then doxycycline is a drug of choice. It is okay to use doxycycline in children who are less than 8 years old, and just recognize that delays in treatment can lead to fatalities. That can be true, yes, with Rocky Mountain spotted fever, but can be due with ehrlichiosis as well and anaplasmosis. So patients can be quite sick by the time they reach your emergency room or your clinic. Rarely, there are alternate medications that are used because of allergy or pregnancy, and I'm not going to go into these now, but there are some alternate agents there, but the literature to support their efficacy is not very strong. Confirmatory labs are not going to guide empiric treatment. If the differential diagnosis includes Neisseria meningitidis, then you should treat both. And prophylaxis of tick bites for the rickettsial tick-borne diseases isn't recommended at this time. The lab diagnosis of tick-borne rickettsial disease are shown here, focusing on Ehrlichia anaplasma together and Rocky Mountain spotted fever. For Ehrlichia and anaplasma, you can request a blood smear for morulae, but you can't hang your hat on that. Whole blood PCR is available, and this would be the most direct way to make the diagnosis. You can also do serologic testing, but recognize that in that acute illness, you're probably going to have negative serology, and you won't be able to make the diagnosis until several weeks down the road when you do convalescent serology. With Rocky Mountain spotted fever, serology is the primary way you make a diagnosis, but again, you're going to need acute and convalescent serology typically, so it's a diagnosis made in hindsight. You can do skin biopsy with immunopathology, but again, that's not going to be back for multiple days. And PCR, there's limited utility at present to use that for a diagnosis. Our last case is a 68-year-old woman who returns from a two-week camping or canoe trip in New England 1 week ago. This was in July. She comes to you now with 4 days of fevers, chills, headache, malaise. She has had no known tick bites, and no eschars are visible on her body. Her temperature is 100.3. She has some plus minus scleral ectoris. There's no rash. There's no lymphadenopathy. There's no neck stiffness. On the labs, you have a hemoglobin of 11.2, platelet count of 130,000. Her white count is 7. Her total bili is 1.6. Her direct bili is 0.2. Her ALP/FOS is normal. AST and ALT are about 100, and blood cultures are pending. All right, so you decide to give her, because of her travel history and her systemic symptoms with fever and some of the labs, you think this could potentially be anaplasma. So you give her 100 doxycycline, 100 milligrams BID for 10 days. And a week later, she comes into your office, and her anaplasma PCR indeed was positive. Her Lyme antibody was negative, but she's telling you that she continues to have some low-grade fevers and chills and malaise, she acknowledges that there's been modest improvement, but she's still not feeling herself. Now in labs, you see a hemoglobin of 10.5. The platelet count is 110,000. LDH is 380. Total bili is 2. Direct bili is 0.2. AST and ALT are improved at 40 and 48. Not quite normal yet. All right, so what is the next best step or steps if some of you want to do more than one thing? All right, so here's one option. You can begin ceftriaxone and stop doxycycline because you think perhaps the doxycycline isn't working. You can change the doxycycline to an IV form for similar reasons. You would request a blood smear for parasites, or you complete the doxycycline as planned because this sometimes patients with anaplasma infection take a while to get better. All right, does anybody want to do number one? Transition over to ceftriaxone. Okay. Number two, change doxycycline to an IV form. Next, obtain a blood smear for parasites. All right, or complete the doxycycline as planned. Okay, so some people want to do three and four. And three and four were the correct answers. Okay, so this is a patient who had a Babesia infection in addition to anaplasma infection. So on the blood smear that you would get, I don't know if you would order this as malaria smear, Guillain sustain, et cetera, but here are some of the intraerythrocytic parasite forms of Babesia infection. Classically, sometimes these will form a cross form, so you'll have them sticking up like that form, called a Maltese cross, but they don't always do that. They can look very similar to malaria parasites. So the exposure history is going to be important. So the diagnosis of babesiosis, consider in any patient with a febrile illness and residence in or travel to endemic area within 2 months or blood transfusion within the last 6 months. A strong clinical suspicion is required because there are no classic signs of this infection. Automated blood counters will not detect the intraerythrocytic parasites. and you should suspect a co-infection with anaplasma if there's more severe disease or poor response to treatment for Lyme or anaplasma. So it goes both ways in terms of the potential for multiple infections. So a diagnostic algorithm is shown here. I won't spend a lot of time looking at this, but if you generally, what's first recommended is to do a thin blood smear. If that's positive, then you give antimicrobial therapy if they're in the category of patients who warrant therapy. But if you have persistent symptoms and a negative blood smear, then you can go on to repeat the blood smear, or you can do a PCR or antibody assay. All right. So treatment of babesiosis is one of those tick-borne illnesses where you're not going to get it right if everything is treated with doxycycline, all right? So that's something to remember. There are typically two different combination medications that are recommended, in part depending on severity of illness. So generally, the first regimen that's recommended is etobicoke and azithromycin, which I'm trying to show here, all right? And the second combination of medications are clindamycin and quinine for the more severely ill. I will say this, because of poor tolerance and availability of quinine, experts will often recommend that if you have a severely ill patient, that you should probably add clindamycin to this combination of the etobicoke and azithromycin. Not all patients are recommended to be treated, so you may find a patient who you have a positive report of their blood smear, but they don't have symptoms, or if they're immunocompetent, then some experts would say you treat if they have evidence for continued infection at 3 months. All right. And how long you treat depends on the immune state of the patient and if they have now a relapse. So duration of treatment can be 1 to 2 weeks versus 4+ weeks. If you have severe disease, consideration of red blood cell exchange should occur, and also the addition of clindamycin, as I alluded to. And as I mentioned, it is not very common now that people would use quinine in treatment. Some emerging tick-borne illness that I'll mention, this is mostly for you to be aware of, as opposed to that we're going to spend a lot of time on them, are the Borrelia miyamotoi. The epidemiology is similar to Lyme disease because its tick vector is the Ixodes tick. This is more closely related to the organisms that cause relapsing fever than the organisms that cause Lyme disease, and the manifestations then are more like that of relapsing fever with a flu-like illness, and you may have some potential relapse, but that isn't one of the classic features of that. Diagnosis is can be by antibody and PCR, but these are not widely available, all right? So I think if you have concern about that, then I would be in communication with probably with your public health lab, or Iowa Department of Public Health. And the treatment is similar to Lyme disease, so treatment is with doxycycline. Borrelia mayonii, just a few patients diagnosed with this, the epidemiology is Minnesota and Wisconsin, and so that has to do with the fact that the testing was done at the Mayo Clinic on some patients who weren't fitting into the typical Lyme picture. The vector is Ixodes tick, and here again, the illness is a flu-like illness with nausea, vomiting, but a diffuse rash is a manifestation of this illness. And typically, some of the Lyme disease tests should capture most of these patients. Treatment is similar. There's something called the Heartland virus, which has been diagnosed in Missouri. The tick is the amblyomma tick. And these patients manifest with a flu-like illness, can have prominent anorexia that can last for several weeks. And on laboratory studies, you can see some low white blood cell count and low platelet, and that can often trigger consideration of this. Diagnosis is made with the help of the State Health Department and the CDC, no treatment. And then I'm not certain how to pronounce this, Powassan, it's named after a city in Ontario. This also has an epidemiology like Lyme disease, Ixodes tick. Here, CNS disease is possible, and this can be quite severe. And again, diagnosis would be made with State Health Department and CDC. So I bring these up in part because as we become more aware of them, it could be that we would well be making more diagnoses over time. So again, this is for your reference, so I'm not going to go down this. This is mostly a summary of things I've already been talking about. Those are the major tick-borne illnesses. Here are some of the minor tick-borne illnesses. Things we didn't talk about today are things like tularemia, which can be transmitted by ticks as well as by handling small animals. There's Colorado tick fever, tick paralysis, et cetera. So these are quite uncommon, and I won't take our time talking about that. So the take-home points, just recognize that the risk of the tick-borne illnesses classically are spring, summer, and fall. Recognize if you have a warm fall like we did last year or an early spring that the months when you have to consider these illnesses increases. Seek occupational, recreational travel history. Don't rely on a history of a tick bite. Erythema migrans, it's a clinical diagnosis of Lyme disease. If there's an exposure history, recognize the diversity of Lyme signs and symptoms over time. A presumptive diagnosis of tick-borne rickettsial disease warrants treatment, empiric treatment. Recognize the risk for co-infection if you have the Ixodes vector, and then recognize the emergence of new pathogens. So just realize that the various newer both viruses and rickettsial illnesses we spoke about, to me, that tells us that there are more out there that we just haven't identified yet. All right, here's some references for you, and I will take a few questions in these last minutes.
What is the endemic area for babesiosis?
Yes, so that is very similar to, it's a bit of a puzzlement in that it's classically in the Northeast, but there are cases in the upper Midwest as well, so the Wisconsin, Minnesota area. I'm a bit puzzled because the vectors are more widespread, or I guess I would view it as where we have the Ixodes vector, we should have the potential for babesia, but I'm not aware of any babesia diagnoses being made in the state of Iowa, for example. So again, whether that's a matter of time as the endemic area spreads and us becoming more aware of the need to attempt to make the diagnosis.
If you have a person who presents with either a Bell's palsy or a Guillain-Barré syndrome in the summertime but has no history of tick exposure or tick bites, do you test them for tick-borne diseases?
So the minority of patients who have Bell's palsy will have it be due to Lyme disease. So I think if you're in an endemic area, then I would say, yes, I would test. I think especially if you have bilateral Bell's palsy, then the odds of it being related to Lyme disease go up significantly. So I would say that would I test if I was in an endemic area, and even if someone tells me, well, I have pretty limited time outdoors, but if they have a dog who goes in and out and things like that, I would probably test. So, but if you tell me you're in, you know, Arizona or something, then I would say no in terms of pretest probability. All right, I'll stick around a couple minutes. Thank you for your attention.